Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. My name is Oscar Hernandez, and I am a second-year Master in Public Affairs student here at the Woodrow Wilson School. I am pleased to be with you this evening and to have the honor to introduce our guest speaker, Ambassador Juan Carlos Pinzón, who received his Master's in Public Policy here at the Wilson School in 2010. Ambassador Juan Carlos Pinzón has been Colombia's ambassador to the United States for the past 16 months, where he has been responsible for maintaining the strategic partnership between the countries as Colombia moves forward in its efforts to secure a sustainable peace. Previously, Ambassador Pinzón served for nearly 4 years as Colombia's Minister of Defense, where he led the nation's police and military forces in dealing severe blows to the illegal and terrorist armed groups operating in the territory, including FARC, ELN, and criminal bands. His tenure was characterized by the development of a new strategic concept that linked a decisive offensive against terrorism and criminality with a new effort to improve the equipment, training, and welfare of the men and women serving in uniform as well as their families. Additionally, he put in place a transformative plan of force development for the Colombian Armed Forces through 2030. These efforts resulted in an improved security environment, as reflected by the lowest homicide rate in 35 years, the absence of terrorist actions by FARC or ELN in 89% of the territory, as well as the absence of kidnapping in 91% of Colombian municipalities. Prior to serving as Minister of Defense, Ambassador Pinzón was Chief of Staff to President Juan Manuel Santos and Vice Minister of Defense. An economist by training, Ambassador Pinzón graduated with honors while earning a Bachelor of Science degree from Universidad Javeriana in Bogotá, and received a Master of Science in Economics from the same university. He has also completed advanced courses in International Relations and Strategic Studies at Johns Hopkins University, and in Science and Technology at Harvard University. Ambassador Pinzón joins us in a very exciting time for Colombia, just 2 weeks after the Colombian Congress approved a final peace agreement with FARC. The agreement is the product of 6 years of intense negotiations and was modified after being narrowly rejected in a referendum earlier this year. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Juan Carlos Pinzón.
Gracias, Oscar. Muy generoso. Thank you so much, Oscar. You know, thank you for this introduction. I have to confess that I do a lot of public talks these days, you know, and on my time as Deputy Minister, Chief of Staff of the President, and Minister of Defense, and now Ambassador, I go to schools to you know, some of the greatest colleges in the United States and certainly my country. I have the opportunity to talk on think tanks and different audiences. But this is the first time in many years that I feel some kind of heat and nervousness, if I can describe it like that. You know, it's not easy to come back to Woodrow Wilson School. It's not easy to come back to this wonderful auditorium, and it's not easy to see you all and knowing that you have very tough questions, and that the room is full of smart people that can bring, you know, anything that can be unexpected. So really, I feel very honored to be here, back to Princeton. All of you are fortunate to be here. Believe me, when you leave this place, you will look back to yourselves and think how great was the opportunity and how unique is the opportunity to be a student here at Princeton. So take advantage of it. That will be my first recommendation. As I said, it's great to be here, and I would like to talk to you on three different issues, all of them connected. The first one, the relationship between Colombia and the United States, and some fun facts about Colombia, because it's important to have some context on why we're here, what is the importance of the relationship, and why the United States is so relevant for what has happened in Colombia recently and what can happen in the years to come. Second, I would like to talk to you about how we did it. You know, what is what we did in Colombia? how we were able to transform from probably a failed state into a nation that is full of challenges, by the way, but that somehow is becoming an example of some lessons that can be applied in other places. And finally, I would like to talk to you about the future. The future, because as much as you might think, my generation, the next generation, we Colombians today of this time would be the first generation of Colombians in 50 years that might talk about not having a country in conflict. So the question is that true? How are we going to handle this? What is to the future of Colombia? What kind of policy or policies can we and we should be applying or thinking? Honestly, on that part, what I want is to challenge you. We're here at Princeton. We're here in a place full of some of the greatest professors in the world, some of the greatest experts, and some of the most talented students. We need to think, you know, and I need you to help me think. How are we going to do the years to come in Colombia? Let me start by the first subject, the U.S.-Colombia relationship. It's an old relationship. Actually, the first time the U.S. and Colombia had a connection was before we were independent, both the United States and Colombia. By the year 1748, an admiral, the most successful British admiral of the time, Admiral Vernon, came to the coast of Cartagena. He came with the British fleet, and in his crew, he had someone very special. He had the brother of George Washington. And on the other side in Cartagena, we had Blas de Lezo, a Spanish admiral, Spanish commander, that was wounded, you know, without an eye, without an arm, without a leg. And his job was to defend Cartagena from the British Empire. Well, story ends that we defend the city well, we meaning the Spanish in that case, and the British could not make it, so they leave. They leave mainly because they could not sustain long-term there because of tropical disease, by the way. That was the main threat to the British sailors. So they came back, and they came back up to Virginia, and apparently stayed. And have you heard that George Washington residence is Mount Vernon? That's a relationship, you know. The brother of George Washington took that land. He inherited to President Washington, and that's the Mount Vernon we know today, not so far from Washington, D.C. I think it's an interesting story just to begin and see how the connections happen in the world, you know, in a way that nobody expects. But since then, let me tell you that by the year 1823, Colombia had the first ambassador to the United States. It means that we have already relations for 193 years already. It's a long relationship. Later on, by the year 1880, two captains that fought during the Civil War for the Union Army came to Colombia. Immediately they came to Colombia, we made them colonels, of course, you know, and they came to help us to the foundation of the first formal military academy in Colombia. By the year 85, we had one of our civil wars. We're very active on civil wars in Colombia. We don't like very much to fight others, but we have had our issues, you know, and we have been fighting inside Colombia for a while. In 1902, someone took Panama. We're still looking for who's that guy, who took Panama? You know, that was ours, and someone took it from us. You know who did it and how it happened. Maybe just to refresh you, of course, Panamanians were isolated from capital, from Bogota. And of course, they were hoping to have this canal there, and they found a good partner in a US president, in a US government. And I will not stay onto that, but simply, someone took Panama. That's the truth. And of course, that frees our relationship for something like 20 years. For the time in which President Woodrow Wilson was president of the United States, and the First World War happened, Colombia was so, you know, in so cold relation with the U.S. that we decided to become neutral on that war. By the year 1925, there was a compensation to Colombia for the loss of Panama. Believe me, that compensation will never be enough, but doesn't matter, it was a compensation. And of course, it created a good sense of relationship. Honestly, that was the only time in which we had this encounter. Starting there, after Pearl Harbor, the first Latin American country that came out and declared war to the Axis powers after Pearl Harbor was Colombia. Creating that connection between Colombia and the United States for a long time. In 1948, in Bogota, was created what we know as the Inter-American System. The OAS was created in Colombia, in Bogota. And the first Secretary General of OAS was a Colombian, a former Colombian president, President Lleras, who came and spent time in Washington and was very important. Imagine this in the era of Cold War. Imagine this in a time in which Cold War was going on and coordinating policies in Latin America for national security, for strategic purposes, but certainly for development purposes was critical. By the year 1951, the UN had a test, and the invasion of South Korea happened. The only Latin American country that went with the flag of the UN and shoulder to shoulder with American troops was Colombia. Colombian troops, 5,000 of them, went to Korea. Around 380 were killed. Around 700 were wounded. And still there are some missing in action that anyone can imagine what happened to them. So it was a real commitment from Colombia and the US perspective. In the 60s, early 60s, President Kennedy was caring a lot for the region. And one of the countries he visited was Colombia. And one of the countries in which the Alliance for Progress, that was the name of his policy, tried to, you know, create an effect was in Colombia. In Colombia, there's, in Bogota, actually, the capital city, there's a neighborhood, small neighborhood of some like 1.5 million people that has the name of President Kennedy, just because the events and the efforts that were done at that time. Let me jump ahead to the war on drugs. It was launched, the war on drugs, and of course, especially in the 80s, Colombia was being affected by the presence of cartels, the Medellin cartel, Cali cartel, and others. The US came to support Colombia, of course, in the middle of a policy that was designed for national security purposes here in the United States, but somehow under the knowledge that the consequences of instability for Colombia were substantial. By the late 90s, the Berlin Wall had fallen already, 1989, and most of guerrillas, Marxist guerrillas of Latin America, of the world itself, disappear. Other kind of terrorist activities came to the world. So we saw the Islamist terror or the liberation wars in certain parts or independence war in certain parts. But mainly the Marxist element of guerrilla came in the 60s, 50s, 60s, disappeared. Not in Colombia. In Colombia, that case was the last one, maybe the only one, that even still, as of today, exists. Drug money allowed that guerrilla to be funded, and of course, that funding of crime and mafia portrayed some of the things that happened in the country and deteriorate even the tissue of the way guerrilla was perceived and behave. I think that was a very important element. So Plan Colombia was launched. 16 years ago, Plan Colombia was launched as an integrated policy in which, of course, national security efforts were key, But other efforts, such as development, such as strengthening institutions, justice, were substantial. And that set of policies that were mainly led by Colombians, executed by Colombians, performed by Colombians, were Colombians that were the ones that were killed, were Colombians the ones that were affected by the problem, but we had the United States, a friend, that contributed to the enhancement and enabling of our capabilities to confront the challenge. That, of course, was very helpful to the moment in which we have been the past 4 or 5 years in a negotiating process that is, you know, doing peace from strength, but in which again, and I mentioned the word United States again, the US has been playing a role with a special envoy trying to contribute to the process of negotiating and ending once and for all the conflict. As you see, the relationship between Colombia and the United States is a long one, and it's a strong one. I'm sure here we're full of American citizens, which have to feel proud of the contribution of the United States to a transformation of a nation. But on the other hand, for those who are preparing for policymaking in the years to come, for those who seek to contribute in the international development arena, the case of Colombia, Plan Colombia as we know it, is an interesting and a one that deserves some policy analysis. One thing that I will tell, a little bit of taking the time of behaving as a professor, is that no case can be replicated identically. No case can be just transferred to another place or to another time. But lessons are common, so policy analysis makes a lot of sense in this case. Let me move to the second subject. How do we make it in Colombia? What happened in Colombia? Let me give you some facts about Colombia. Colombia is not a small country. It's the size of Texas, California, and almost New Mexico together. Or for some, it's like 5 times Spain or 3 times Germany. So it's not a small country. No way you can think about it. We're almost 50 million people country. So it means that it's a large market. It's the third largest Latin American country by population, and is the second largest Spanish-speaking country in the world after Mexico, Colombia, Spain, and the United States of America. Those are the Spanish-speaking countries in the world, I'm just telling you. So I think it's very important to understand, you know, the size and importance of the country in terms of what a market it is or what a group of people it is. Now, on the other side, there are some other features. Colombia is a country that is extremely endowed in natural resources. Water is very important. Colombia is the second largest freshwater country in per capita terms in the whole world. Colombia is the third most biodiverse country in the planet. That used to be an issue of a pride for us Colombians to say, but frankly speaking, for a long time, we never understood what was the profit about it. In an era in which everything can be codified, in which genes can be taken out, and you can do things for the good of humanity out of those, being a very biodiverse country gotta mean something else. In an era of climate change, being a rich country in water, tropical forests, and other natural resources gotta be important. Colombia is seen as one of these 10 countries in the world that can double or triple the production of food in the planet. And actually, the consequence of peace creates that opportunity especially and in particular. I think that's very important and another element to think to the future of the country. And let me end with some other two facts. The longest standing democracy in Latin America. In the time of Cold War, everybody found a solution. And typically, they brought dictators, they toppled governments, and that's what happened in Latin America and Asia, and East Asia in general terms. In Colombia, we stay with democracy. Maybe it meant that we took longer to solve our problems, But somehow, you know, the evolution was a result of people will. And I think that's very important and gives a lot of strength to the future. And the final comment on this is Colombia has been the only Latin American country never to default on its debt. And that's very important when you think about investors and when you think people that is willing to commit capital for a long-term decision. It implies prudent macroeconomic management, but on the other side, opportunity and good potential. So I think those are elements that are important to see. Now, I think US strategists and planners saw that by the end of the 90s. Because Colombia, as beautiful as I describe, and you see me, I get passionate about my country, and I feel a lot of emotion to think on the great things we have. I have to tell you, we were on knees by the end of the 90s. Colombia became the most violent country in the Western Hemisphere. Colombia became the country that had the two most violent cities in the whole planet, Medellin and Cali. We were hostages in our own cities. I remember myself not being allowed anymore to travel in the country. Not me, because I was a special, I was a regular citizen. Any citizen, any Colombian, kidnapping was a threat to anyone. Being recruited by an illegal armed group was a threat to anyone. And violence was happening. Homicides were more than 32,000 per year by the year 1998-1999. So we really got into a serious crisis. According to some experts in Washington, they came to the conclusion that by the end of the 90s, there were two failed states in Latin America, Haiti and Colombia. So that was the grading experts were giving to Colombia. So what we did? What happened? First and most important of all, Colombians as a nation wanted a change, voted for a change, and pursue a change. I think this is the most important element of the case of Colombia. I think we cannot establish an individual to be called the hero of the journey, to be the one that, you know, was the only guy who saw it and changed everything. I think it was the people who accepted certain policies, asked for certain policies, and allowed those policies to be performed. I think that's a very important element, democracy itself and the will of people. Sure, some people says, well, but you have to wait so long to get into such a problem, to make such a decision. Well, that's freedom. That's democracy. And that's, in a way, how we perform as society. So I give an important value to that element. Another element that I believe is important was seeking for friends abroad. So I think in very early stages of the whole effort to recover the country, by the end of the 90s, early century, our leaders decided to come outside and said, we are looking for partners and friends. We need international standards. We need to see what's going on in other places, and we need to see what can we learn. And by the way, we need to find real friends. This is why I describe the US-Colombia relationship as important, but here's why, if there's a country in which the United States has a good perception, and the most popular leader usually is the president of the United States, at least as of today. I can tell you that it is because Colombians perceive that the United States came in support of Colombia. That Plan Colombia meant that when we were at knees, the only friend that came and provided some support was the US. And finally, I think that we have to be realistic. In international relations, friends are related to interests. And we have to be pragmatic about it. We don't have to become personal about it or, you know, deviate from practical matters and pragmatism that is required at government senior level. Why the United States care so much about Colombia? I have my own hypothesis. I think first, because of the size and location of the country. The country was just in the middle of the Western Hemisphere. And a failed state in Colombia meant the risk of failure for Central America and South American countries, in a way. This was not a, you know, a one island with few people or another country isolated. It was the country that was, you know, somehow located in the center of the region with a very high numbers in people. In addition to that, I think there was some recognition that drug problem is not a Colombian problem or is not a producer problem. Who consumes this and who buys this and who sells the weapons that come to mafias and to crime and to violence? So some logic of corresponsibility and even US policy was around this. I mention this because I believe that's important to understand why friends become friends and how interests are developed. And I think that was another important element. What was the policy in these years? On one hand, on security matters, we enhance our special operations capabilities, our intelligence capabilities, our mobility technologies. Suddenly, because we now have more than 200 helicopters in a period of 5 years, or because we now have some boats for the rivers, or boats to, you know, move into our coast, we were able to establish territorial control. So having that mobility was not a minor issue. Having a specific intelligence was the opportunity to fight a counterinsurgency or counter-terror war in a way that you minimize the effects to the population, in a way in which you can go and focus on who's really misbehaving and reducing those efforts. And special operations, of course, to enhance the professional standards of the military. But on that security matter, there's a fourth element that is critical and across all this, and very important for leadership: professional standards and standards in human rights. Those elements allow our military and our security forces to become more important and more stronger than even what weapons or security capabilities mean. There's an old saying that says that the value of an army is not the number of assets or capabilities they have, but the strength of their qualities and moral standards. That was very important because we cannot underestimate the consequence of human rights violations in the 80s and 90s. And those issues, of course, create a total misbehavior, but a very bad perception from the people to those that were expected to be protecting them. So achieving legitimacy and promoting the opportunity of these people to behave in a way that our citizens felt protected was critical. Statistics tell today that one of the most appreciated institutions in the country, if not the most appreciated, are the military and the police. But if you ask that 15 or 20 years ago, probably you will see exactly the opposite. So that was not a minor issue and a very significant one. On other fields, the strengthening of justice was critical. And US played a role in this as well. We needed to strengthen our justice in order to go not only after the major criminals, the drug traffickers, or the illegal armed groups, but also corruption. Corruption in politics, that was very important. I have to tell you that our justice has been evolving in a way in which many members of Congress have gone to jail, mayors have gone to jail, and there's the idea that we have these processes. I will not tell you we are not full of challenges, and I will not tell you that there is not a risk of corruption even inside those systems, but the truth is that it creates a credible process that is giving the country some idea and some progress to the credibility of the state itself. And finally, the tools for development. I think we understood, all of us who have been part of these efforts, and I have to tell you on my own experience, the use of force is necessary if legitimate, and is necessary when it's necessary. But usually it doesn't resolve any kind of problem. It gives you an opportunity. It gives you a window of opportunity to do everything else. And I think that was very important, the understanding that development was critical. US aid played a role into this. That agency became important, useful. I think more than the effectiveness of their projects, which there are many critics about it, was the idea of planning on fragile areas of the country and the idea of connecting our own institutions to that set of planning and allowing us to take care and control. My final comments onto this are that we were able to keep a strong decision making in a way that was Colombians who always did its part on the relationship with the United States. I will tell you that in other cases, we have seen the US trying to replace institutions or trying to play a role as the creator of a process. I am not criticizing that. I'm just saying that that was the case in other places. But what I will tell you in the case of Colombia was that the US role was to enable Colombian institutions and capabilities. So it's a very different approach than the ones we have seen in other parts. And maybe that's why we Colombians, willing being the ones that have the will to recover our nation, to do what we have to, that was the real important thing. And then, you know, providing us with certain technologies, with certain assets, with planning and standards in which the US is really full of opportunities and knowledge and experience, became a good and effective tool. I think the other issue we worked well was the sustainable idea of these policies. In Colombia, we changed three presidents already, and still, the concepts and the idea has kept being the same. In the relationship with the United States, we were able to do something that appears not so easy recently, having a bipartisan relationship. Colombia was able to build a bipartisan consensus in which, of course, every party has its own flavor and its own preferences, but the policies were able to sustain after three presidents of the United States and different leaders in Congress. And that was a way in which we were able to move on. I think at the end that this transformation meant that we moved from being this violent country into a virtuous circle of security by providing better security and now having very low homicide rates, the lowest in almost four decades now. We were able to create an environment for economic growth. Investment came back to the country, first and more important of all from Colombians, but then foreign investment as well happened in the country. Colombia became one of the most attractive countries for investors in Latin America and in the middle income countries, attracting more investment than many others. And that resulted in economic growth. The economy has been overperforming the rest of the region for the past 6-7 years in average. And even now that we have been hit by an oil price downturn and somehow commodities effect, the economy continues still to grow at a rate of 2% and even higher than that. But more important than all, this allowed the government to increase its tax collection and establish certain kind of policies on healthcare, on education, on housing, at the end, basic social policies that have resulted in a reduction of poverty in the past decade of almost 50%. We moved from having almost 50% of the population in poverty to levels of 28%. And we moved to have a from having 28% of Colombians in extreme poverty to levels of 11, 10%. Those are very substantial numbers and proof that somehow keeping this policy has had an important result. Let me get into the last subject, peace and how do we move forward? I think that all of us who have been in the responsibility of making decisions in the past decade, in Colombia, past two decades, and especially those of us who have to make decisions to defeat threats, to defeat terrorists, or put it in a different word, to make use of force for the purpose of the benefit of Colombians and to protecting Colombians, we always knew, we always understood that the only logic about it was first and more important than all, protecting our people. But second, getting to the point of establishing a different situation in which we can have peace. And that's, at the end, what we try, all of us. So we were able, with the decision-making and leadership of President Santos, to move into a peace negotiation process, a peace negotiation that resulted in a process of, let me simplify this very well, if you want someone to deliver its weapons, stop killing, stop being in crime, or at least offering that, you need to offer something in exchange. So at the end, what Colombian government offered was a set of transitional justice that implies telling the truth, doing reparatory measures, but at the end reducing the kind of penalties that they were going to receive. Is this an issue to debate? For Colombian society, it is. It's part of what it is, you know, it's a political decision. And of course, those who have felt affected or see the potential of being a victim do not like the idea of seeing someone that was in such crimes not to go into jail for a long time. But on the other side, if you want to do that, you have to go after them. So it implies spending the resources, spending the human lives that imply doing that solution. I think the conclusion of making peace through negotiation came after Colombian government became absolutely convinced that the balance of power was on the side of the state, that we can do peace from strength, and by doing peace from strength, it implied that we have achieved on a counterinsurgency warfare a military victory in terms of denying forever the enemies of Colombia, in this case, the FARC, to achieve any power or any objective by the use of terror or by the use of weapons. So when you get to that conviction, you can enlarge the time and even degrade more the other side, or as President Santos decided, he could do a peace agreement in which he will find a shortcut to reduce the lives that were expended or the resources that were expended and somehow create a different condition. In order to do that, we only could do it if the other side, in this case the FARC, understood that fighting was not worth anymore and that fighting for them was just losing ground, losing their own lives as it was happening. So that was the way the process was set up. Will always be a debate, if not in this political issue, but in any other political issue, if you are making the best decision or not, if you were able to do a better agreement or not, that's absolutely part of politics and part of life. I saw a little bit of that when I saw some of the recent agreements in the Middle East here in the United States. And it's a good debate, and it's a fair debate. You know, people is allowed to give opinions, and there are different experts that can come with different responses. But the truth is that an agreement was achieved. And that was historic for Colombia, because that was the first time in 52 years that we were able to reach agreement. So that's the historic part of it. Not the content itself, it's the historic part of making an agreement. The other part, what was under discussion was how they were going to demobilize, disarm, and reintegrate into society. And of course, some set of policies related to land or related to participation in politics as the elements of discussion. As I said, I think that was important to move on to that. And it's now an opportunity of having a different reality than the one we have had for a long time. But of course, an opportunity that needs to be absolutely well thought in a way that we can make this peace sustainable. And by the way, that it resulted in a benefit for majority of Colombians and not only for a certain group. That's the debate I think we're gonna have the years to come. And that's the big questions we will have in policy. What will going to be the best set of policies that we will need to implement to keep the security of Colombians, to keep the will of peace, to make peace stick in a different perspective? How to take development to marginal areas of Colombia that are distant, that because of geography are very difficult? How to do that in a way that you create a value-added chain that allows us, those people, to get income, to get jobs, and to really do not think on alternative illegal economies as their source of life. Those are the challenges we're gonna have the years to come. But in addition to that, we are a 50 million people country, competitive. We are part of the Pacific Alliance with Mexico, Chile, and Peru. And we are looking to the world on how to make our future more effective. Actually, Colombia is a young country. Almost 60% of our population is under 30. So that implies that not only will we have to offer jobs for a long time, but we'll have to care for social security for a long time, but also that we have a big opportunity of connecting this young population into what is called the fourth generation or the fourth industrial revolution. How do we connect our people onto that? How we educate our people to new technologies and allow them to work into that environment and allow them to be strong participants of this world economic revolution that is going on that, you know, here in America you recently saw your own decision making, you know? How do we connect onto that and how we make this peacetime an opportunity for all that? How do we continue to fight organized crime? How do we continue to do it in a way that is effective, that denies the return of conflict? Recently, I published a book on the history of Colombian armed forces for the year 1880-1945. Frankly speaking, nobody in this room will read that book ever. You know, there's no way you can be interested about it. It's only me because of my own interest on the history of Colombian armed forces. But let me give you some findings that will be interesting about it. As I told you at the beginning, we are not a country that has not been in conflict or has not been fighting for a long time. We have had internal conflicts for a while. In that period of time, almost 100 or more than 100 years ago, depending on the way you measure, we had our own internal conflicts. And external conflicts, actually. And the question was why this happened? That was my question for the purpose of that book. And what I found was that, on one hand, there were a lot of unmet promises. After every war, people do promises, precisely to end the war, precisely to stimulate and create, you know, a better environment to the future. But if you don't meet those promises, as happened after Plan Marshall in Europe, you create the conditions for the next war, because the argument will be that the problems that were in depth were not solved. So this is why I care so much to think on the right set of policies to make this sustainable, because in the past history of my own country, we have not met all the promises we have done after wars, and that creates that cycle. And of course, the fact of weak state presence. What we have done very well in the past 15 years in Colombia was to recover the state presence, the control of the territory. And still in some areas of the country, still we're waiting for other set of policies to come. education, roads, electricity, even in some parts. You won't believe, but that's what it is. It's part of the challenge. So we cannot weak the state presence anymore. It happened 100 years ago, and probably that contributed to the deterioration of the security conditions and probably create the idea of ungoverned spaces that were at the end run by someone else or taken over by someone else, criminals or drug traffickers or illegal armed groups seeking for whatever their hope of power it was. So I think we are in front of a very interesting time. When I think about future opportunities that are coming, one that I see as a very important issue is the idea that Colombia is expected to be in OECD, as part of OECD, along 17, hopefully before the year 2018. That's important because that will oblige us to keep some level of policies and international comparable standards that are very important on all sets of policies and all sets of issues. Finally, I think that we have good opportunities on several issues related to peace, for business, for trade, for development. One, of course, is the idea of using new technology for energy. In those isolated parts of Colombia, now there are technologies in the world happening, from solar to wind to other technologies that are being evolved in a very fast path. Maybe those areas do not need to get in the grid anymore. Maybe those areas need to just have access to the energy. So it's very important. Forestry, of course, in an era of climate change, being a country that can be strong in forestry is very important. And of course, agribusiness. The world, especially in Asia, especially in Central Asia, India, the demand for food is growing and growing and growing. And probably having this opportunity of peace to expand our agribusiness base is an interesting one. Not to forget extractive industries, but that are environmental friendly. That's a big challenge. But a country like Colombia cannot just sleep in wells of oil and gas and just not using that wealth to create a better future that denies violence and crime and war again to the future. And finally, innovation. What I learned about my country, and especially on the business I was in, security, and our military, what I learned a lot was the ingenuity, the inventiveness of our people, the way they can adapt and create solutions to very complex problems, and someone will come with an idea. We are an entrepreneurial country, and hopefully we can promote with certain policies that innovation. Well, as you see, I kind of follow and move through these three subjects that I hope, you know, leave you with some ideas on what has happened in Colombia, what should come next, and how we did it. And very important, the way we relate with the United States as a good friend, a good partner. And yes, you have to feel proud. There are places in the world that U.S. is seen as a good friend and as a good partner. Certainly in Colombia, it is. Well, thank you so much. As I said, it was a great opportunity to be here at this auditorium. Thank you so much. I understand we have a...
Yes, we will now open the floor for questions.
All right.
Hi, my name is Andy Joe. I'm a first-year master's MPA here at the Woodrow Wilson School. Thank you so much for coming. My question is focused on the initial reform efforts that you outlined in the first part of your talk, the immediate efforts that followed the electoral victory of a new government when, in your words, when the Colombian people demanded a change. You mentioned a lot of the reforms that were put in place, strengthening security forces, strengthening state capacity, fighting corruption. It occurs to me that a lot of these moves are, many societies and countries have tried to make those kinds of changes, but the thing that constrains those are not so much that people didn't want to do them, but that there were structural obstacles in place, a lack of resourcing or vested interest that wanted things to remain the way they were. So I'm curious to hear a little more about how Colombia was able to overcome those structural obstacles, where the resourcing came from that enabled them to make those investments, and what kinds of institutional reforms you could put in place to break past those vested interests that perhaps, for instance, would have had a stake in, you know, keeping a corrupt system in place the way it was. Thank you.
I think Colombia had a strong previous sound macroeconomic management. And I think that was a good condition to start, you know, because despite the crisis, sound macroeconomic management was always in place. That allowed, I think, two other elements. One, some level of leadership well-educated abroad that was very much connected to the main institutions and, you know, to be able to accede to other places for learning and for ideas into policy. And the other part was the fact that I described of Colombian government, Colombian leadership, precisely seeking for an openness in the country. So many of the ideas of reform came out of those. Many came, you know, in a way that some of these ideas were taking us own, and of course were developed for our own size, you know, and for our own reality. But I think that attitude to, you know, be open to the world, have educated people that can be connected was very important. By the way, you know, for those who are not Americans that are coming to school here, that's one of the big advantages of coming out of this type of studies, that then you have a lot of contacts, a lot of access to knowledge, and the opportunity to really try to connect. And, you know, when it's not one, two, but, you know, hundreds or thousands of people, and especially in the leadership levels, both in public or private sector, it creates, you know, a positive opportunity when there's political will to do things.
Como colombiano, me siento orgulloso de tenerlo aquí.
Mucho gusto.
Welcome. As a Colombian, I'm very proud to have you here. The question that I want to address is about peace. Usually when we're speaking about peace is because there's a lack of it. And especially in terms of what we're talking about today, a lot of Colombian citizens that were displaced because of the internal civil war. There's around 7 million during this war that have been displaced, around 220,000 that have lost their lives. It is estimated right now that there's around 550,000 that are still displaced, but Colombia has only been able to identify around 10,000 of them. Personally, I am one of those people. I had to leave Colombia at the age of 4 because the FARC had kidnapped a lot of my family members, murdered my father, and throughout my life trying to find, I guess, a home in other countries, I never saw, I guess, support from the country that I call my own still. So I guess the question is, when trying to establish peace, not just internally, but I guess as well to the people that have been directly affected by it, to those that still have not been able to find peace outside of their country, those that wish to return, but they don't really see enough support from their country to have the courage to do it. They don't feel that, they might not feel wanted. As I said, from the 550,000 that are estimated to be displaced, only around 10,000 have been identified. So my question to you is, I guess, what kind of policies can we implement, or what kind of help can we give to these Colombian citizens that wish to return to the country or wish to find peace, at least somewhere else?
Well, first of all, I'm sorry for your story, you know, your personal story. That's unfortunately not an isolated one, as you said, you know, that was a challenge of our country. Second, as hard as it sounds, I promise you that these people were seriously punished. And the only reason why we're doing peace is because they understood by the commitment of our nation and in the support of our armed forces that they were going to be defeated as they were. You know, so that will never create any solution to anyone's problem, but at least I can assure you that that's, you know, a way in which we move to peace. And now we're entering into a different era, and we Colombians will need to think about reconciliation. And reconciliation, first of all, is with our own ghost and sentiments. That's a fact. All of us Colombians have a case, a story, a personal one, that we can tell what happened. And we need to take advantage of this time, try to turn the page, not to forget, not to forget. I always insist on to that. You know, history is about remembering and knowing about history. So we try to repeat the less we can on what is not good and try to, you know, repeat as much as we can on what we did well, or at least be inspired by it. And finally, you know, I will encourage you to come back. You know, and if I have the power to invite you to come, let me know how can I do it. Because, you know, people like you that have been seeing the world, you know, the only positive benefit that you have today is that probably you travel the world, you adapt to live in other countries, you have access to information, education, and people. Maybe that's the next way we can help to make our country better, and by doing our country better, to help other countries, you know, and to, you know, be effective to the future. So let's not allow others that maybe do not deserve to stay at home managing the country. Let's do it ourselves, you know, and that will be what I would encourage you to do. So if I have the power to invite you in a way, let me know, all right?
Gracias.
De nada.
Thank you, Ambassador, for this wonderful talk. I was interested to know that you mentioned that the Colombian government decided to, after it had achieved a military victory, it then decided to engage in negotiations, and which led to the recent peace agreement. From what I know, there's a long drawn history, and there is a strong tendency to dehumanize the other side from both sides. And once any of the sides actually achieves military victory, there is once again a very strong tendency to actually, you know, commit genocide or just like eradicate the other side altogether. We saw that in Sri Lanka, where LTTE was sort of demolished. So I was just interested to know what went through the minds of Colombian leadership, and how did they manage to choose to do what they did and not go all out and sort of decimate the other side?
As you may know, President Santos was awarded last Saturday the 2016 Nobel Peace Prize. And he delivered a beautiful speech that I will encourage anyone to read it. It is written in Spanish and in English and French and Portuguese that I know. It makes sense to read it because, you know, he puts a lot of his own sentiment, ambition. Being a wartime minister as he was, you know, I served with him as well as his deputy there. And in my case, I think I was the last wartime minister we had, hopefully really, for the purpose of this conflict. And I think he said something that was very humane, and I believe is important. You know, when you have an opponent, an enemy, the first thing you need to find out is how to see that not as an enemy, but as an adversary, and find a way in which you can not necessarily agree, but at least agree not to treat as enemies. That was a strong message I believe he delivered that day. The second one, I think, comes from my own sentiment that I believe he expressed. First than anything, our leadership has been democratic, elected by the people, and restricted by the laws, not only of our constitution or our own system, but by the laws of men, you know, in the sense that we are supposed to be there to do the right thing. We are supposed to be there to understand in a pragmatic way time and measure the realities, and by doing so, making decisions and performing in consequence. I think that's a little bit what happened in Colombia. We were not in the middle of a dictatorship that its own purpose was to eliminate another side or something alike. We were in a democracy that was working to bring security to the people. And by bringing security to the people, we were achieving a very important objective that allowed us to move to seek for other alternatives. In a way, if you think Colombia by the end of the 90s, early century, we only have one of the four type of efforts that a state can perform, the use of force, because that was the only policy that we were going to be effective with. But as much as we recover security and as much as we recover the presence of the state, the other three elements of, let's say, power of states came back. The use of policy, social policy and other policies, and the consequence that, that it creates. The use of politics, because politics at the end is how you relate to others and how to create spaces for of solution of whatever the problem. And the use of diplomacy. How do you involve others in a way that you know you can produce a different result and effect? So I think that was the other pragmatic approach. We moved from being a country that only had one element of power at disposal, use of force, but by doing that, we were able to recover four set of elements of power, and we perform all at the same time. This is where we are. Now, the challenges we have in the future are big, and as I said at the end of this conversation, to make this sustainable is a very challenging generational effort we will have to in the years to come.
As you mentioned, Colombia has a reoccurring...
You're Colombian too?
Yes.
All right. How many Colombians I have in the room? Ah, that was a Colombian room. Next time I speak in Spanish, you know?
As you mentioned, Colombia has a reoccurring history with civil war, especially at the core of it seems to be extreme leftist groups, as the FARC were. And now it seems, when you look at the history of Colombia, it seems that it may be fighting an ideology more than one specific group, as we can see from current situations where it's not only the FARC, but there are other groups that are also springing up. And, you know, doing peace agreements with each one is a possibility, but, and I actually liked the peace agreement that was done with the FARC, and I was in support of it because it is a step forward. But how do we manage it so that those new groups that are coming up are, in a sense, prevented from, you know, turning into the new FARC, right? How can we stop this problem?
I understand. Well, as you know, we have not made one demobilization in Colombia. We have made several. Before this peace process with the FARC, we had six other demobilizations, AUC, M19, ERG, EPL, Quintin Lame, and others. And as you know, this was not the first negotiation with the FARC. This was the fourth one or the fifth one, depending on how you remind history. So we have experience seeing that after demobilization, unfortunately, some members come back for illegal business and crime. And of course, it's natural to think that that might happen. This is why one of the important elements, in my opinion, that we established as a condition during the negotiation was not allow the FARC to negotiate on the future of the armed forces, because we want to keep those armed forces to be adapted, to modernize, to be flexible, but to be ready to confront misbehavior, crime, and security challenges. And I think we will have to do that in an effective way. We will need to be effective, first of all, in proving that the being in the peace agreement makes sense on the good manner, you know, on protecting their lives is very important, on, you know, providing these opportunity to re-engage with society, to reintegrate. But at the same time, we will need to be effective on being deterrent enough to show that whomever misbehaves will be punished through the legal system with the due process, but with the strength of our justice. And that's a thing we need to be effective on. So when you present your question, I will just come back to you by saying, these are the kind of challenges we need to think policy-wise the years to come, because those are the issues and the big questions that are going to be in place, and we'll need to handle those. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for your words. My question has to do with former President Uribe. As you are well aware, he was not particularly in favor of this agreement. Do you think he can be co-opted into supporting this, or do you think he can become a very divisive figure which may really hamper the progress you hope to see?
Well, as of today, everybody knows, has not been helpful to the actual process. But let me tell you how I see things. First, I see President Pastrana, President Uribe, and President Santos as great leaders of Colombia. And we will have to look to them in a historic perspective some years from now as a group of people that contribute to transform the country and that was able to bring the international community, fight the war, and then move us to peace, to the next chapter. So I rather see him as a contributor to what already happened. But the future is for the next generation. The future is related to those who will have to have the challenge to lead the country in the years to come. And of course, it will be great if we can create more consensus. It will be great if we can learn out of those who contribute to the past and to lead with their efforts to transform the country. They deserve all the credit, but we will need to build upon what is being constructed as of today, correct whatever is being feasible to correct, but especially move forward to try to take the country to the next level. I think that's the way things should look like. As you might know, none of the former presidents can run for future elections in Colombia, so there's an opportunity for leadership, consensus, and gratitude, no doubt, gratitude to the contributions that have been done in the past two decades.
Thank you.
I would yield to the student.
I'm not a student, but thank you very much.
Colombiano también?
Yes.
Okay.
You highlighted two very important points during your talk. One was the key role that the U.S. has played in our history as Colombian, as Colombia as a country, and second, the important or the critical point that is going to be the implementation of the peace agreements. That's going to be the critical part, and even maybe harder than the actual making of the agreement. So I'm wondering how the Colombian government sees the presidency of Donald Trump in terms of what's the role that it's going to play in this critical point when I'm imagining we are going to need the support of the U.S. as it has happened before. So I haven't heard so far, but I'm sure you are better informed than I am on what's his position on these agreements that we just signed last.
Very well. I said before, we have been able to handle a very effective bipartisan relationship. And of course, everybody has a personal opinion in life, and in the world of today, with all the technology, with all the information flowing, everybody has an opinion. But whatever the opinion, it's up to the American people, whatever the decisions they made, and whatever they decide. And we're not the ones that will, criticize or, try to decide for those who have to, the American people. So what we do care is to keep that strong bipartisan relationship. We have been able to work with different presidents, and we expect to work with the next president of the United States and with the next Congress and to those that are after them as well. in a pragmatic and effective way, in a way that is, of course, beneficial for the interests of Colombians, and of course, beneficial for the interests of the United States citizens. That's the way we will keep working. Now, on very specific issues, of course, when we think about the next phase, we had a program that was named Plan Colombia that I kind of praise and describe as a positive. I will never say it's perfect. I will never say no flaws. I mean, it was a very effective policy in general terms, in terms of Colombia being a violent country and resulting in a more advanced and transformed country after applying that policy. The years to come, we're asking and we're discussing a new program that we call Peace Colombia, Paz Colombia. And Paz Colombia is seeking to focus our efforts on sending more development to the marginal areas of the country, giving access to these new technologies that I was describing, even on energy and other sources. On the other side, strengthening justice. Remember, we have to create a new jurisdiction, the transitional justice, the peace justice jurisdiction. It's very important for that justice to work. That will be very important for making peace stable. And getting U.S. support and knowledge to this is very, very useful. And also, continue to make justice to work, because ordinary justice is what any citizen requires. And the best way to deny anyone thinking of using or doing justice by its own hands is if justice works effectively. And finally, keep our edge on confronting organized crime, drug trafficking, illegal mining, human trafficking, and even extortion. But not only from Colombia perspective, as we did during Plan Colombia, that was, in our case, looking inward, but now we understand we have a role to play, and we're already playing that role in Central America, the Caribbean, Mexico, and others. In the past 5 years, we have trained 25,000 people from all these countries in order to give them, transferring our experience in a humble way, but telling them, this is what we did, and this is how we train, and this is how you can be trained. So now our security perspective is, you know, beyond our borders in terms of helping to create a stable and peaceful and hopefully prosperous environment for the region. That's, you know, what is in mind onto that Paz Colombia. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk. And I think the Woodrow Wilson School should show a great sense of pride in how what you learned here was to negotiate in a way in which you don't make the opposition the enemy. And the questions that have been asked by Woodrow Wilson students show that they are learning that lesson. I have one point and one question. And the point I'd like to make is that if you look back at the origins of FARC before the narco-terrorists began funding them, many of the things that the Colombian government has now agreed to in terms of land reform, jobs, social economic justice, were things that were being asked for back then, but for whatever the political reasons, they weren't available. So the trade-off that you've made is both an honorable one and a smart one. And I think it's an example to others that negotiating treaties anywhere with insurgents, that one has to realize that some of the programs the insurgents are asking for may in fact be reasonable and should be addressed in that way. The question that I have when you talk about punishment is one of extradition. And it's always been an issue as to whether Colombia would or should be extraditing those Colombians that have been indicted by the United States or currently are under indictment, whether public or secret indictments. And so my question is, in terms of punishment, will the punishment that will be brought forward for criminal activity, narco-terrorism and things like that, be entirely within the jurisdiction of Colombia, or will some of them be extradited? I raise that question because with the new president, with President-elect Trump, I would assume that he would take a very strong position that failure to cooperate with extradition would get payback. So my question really is part of the agreement that all punishment will be internal and exercised under the laws and jurisdiction of Colombia, or will some people still be, when demanded by the United States, extradited?
Well, that's a great question. First, you know, extradition is a sovereign is a sovereign decision. A country decides if it extradites its citizens for committing crimes in other parts of the world or not. Many countries do not do that, others do it. The case of Colombia, Colombia has been extraditing to the US more criminals, citizens of Colombia, than anyone else. There is no other country that has the record of extraditing people who committed different kinds of crimes to the US than Colombia. I think that's an important context to keep in mind. Second, Colombia is not forgetting or putting aside the idea of extradition. Colombia will continue to extradite criminals, as has been a policy for a few decades now. But regarding the agreement, what was agreed was that those members of the FARC that committed crimes as members of the FARC up to the day the agreements were signed will not be extradited. They will be processed by the peace jurisdiction. They will have to tell the truth, explain their crimes, accept the crimes, accept a penalty, and typically do some kind of reparatory measure, like demining, eradicating illegal crops like coca, or doing public works to demonstrate their commitment. If they do not comply to those elements, they will lose all their benefits, and if they commit crimes after their FARC time, those will be considered as ordinary crimes, so can be extradited for the purpose of those new crimes.
Because of the real interaction between the narcotics cartels and FARC, how are you going to define a FARC crime as opposed to a narcotic export crime?
It's very important. What was part of the discussions was that FARC has been presenting themselves as using drug trafficking as a source of financing of their irregular activities. Of course, it's very debatable, and it's a worth discussion to have. But that was agreed, you know, that crimes that were related to their FARC activity, and understanding that that was a FARC activity, will not be included in the extradition process. But if they fall back to crime, they will lose the benefits, and probably they will be judged or, you know, processed by not only the new crimes, but the ones that they had pending. So the incentive, I hope, is high. I hope it works, in a sense that those who were in crime in FARC really commit not to be in crime anymore. But we are in life, we are humans, and we will see, you know, who does and who doesn't, right?
I'm from Venezuela, so I wanted to ask a question about the relationship between Venezuela and Colombia. In this last year, there have been a lot of nonpartisan reports that say that there are a lot of paramilitary groups in the border between Venezuela and Colombia, as well as a lot of like drug cartels. As well, in the last year, President Maduro has taken action to basically deport and violate the human rights of many Colombians living in the border area, especially in Táchira. How do these two different events or factors affect the relationship between both countries? And also, if you could expand a little bit on the role that Cuba has played on the peace agreements and the peace negotiations between the FARC and the Colombian government, that would be great.
Well, thank you for your question. First, you know, Venezuela and Colombia were born the same day and have the same father, you know? So General Bolívar, Simón Bolívar, a prominent Caraqueño from Caracas, from Venezuela, was the founder of a country that was named Gran Colombia. That was the country he founded. And Gran Colombia included Venezuela, Colombia, Ecuador, part of Peru, Panama, and Bolivia. So it was kind of a large country. And of course, it didn't stand not even 10 years, you know? And, you know, it was divided part by part. But I say this because for Colombia, Venezuela will be always extremely important, And for Venezuela, Colombia will be extremely important forever. We are Siamese brothers. We're there, you know. We like to present ourselves as what we are, different countries, but we're not different nations at the end. We're a single nation. So we care for what is going on there, and we're sorry for what we see, and we're thankful for the support that has been provided on the process. That was an achievement by President Santos, you know, at least to make the Venezuelan government to contribute somehow. Now, of course, the border has been challenging for a long time. For many years, the challenging side was the Colombian side. But of course, because of our efforts to recover the country, to recover the security, and sadly, for what has happened, that I will not qualify, I'm ambassador, you know, so I need to be prudent enough not to overstep on other countries' issues. The truth is that on the other side now, there are many problems related to presence of former FARC and FARC itself stay in Venezuela for more than 10 years, the ELN, the criminal bands, and of course, it creates a very complicated environment that especially affects citizens, which is the most critical thing. You know, sometimes in national security, we tend to discuss on, you know, like wars that are, you know, in the minds of planners. In our neighborhood, what matters is what's happening to citizens and how those citizens get affected by, you know, illegal activities and criminal activities from one group of another. We hope for cooperation, you know, and this is an effort that President Santos has done for a long time, spending a lot of efforts and sometimes a lot of his political capital trying to make some cooperation and dialogue feasible, which sometimes looks very difficult, but it's what has happened. On the role of Cuba, I think that Cuba, for the purpose of the peace negotiation with the FARC, did play a role of being the host nation of the dialogues. And of course, I understand that they saw clearly that the FARC didn't have an option of winning anything on the military field. And maybe that made a more evident their intention of being supportive for a negotiated solution. And I think they were helpful. At least that's what the president, President Santos, has described and what some members of negotiating team have said about it. Doesn't mean that Colombia will have the same policies or the same points of view of these two countries I have mentioned. We have been clear that we will move into freedom, democracy, freedom of speech, markets, and you know that's the values we care and defend for, and others do for other things we respect. We don't mingle in the sense of other people issues, but at the same time we care to be effective for our own citizens, and that's the way we will keep working, I think. Thank you. Well, thank you so much. Thank you. Great honor to be here, really. Big, big honor. Thanks.
Thank you for being here.